Good morning. Good to see you this morning. It's kind of funny when you come in and have to introduce yourself to family. But I know some of you are new to First Baptist. So my name is Nancy Riles, Children's and Women's Director. And it's my joy to say welcome this morning and Merry Christmas. And we want to point you to our bulletin, which has a tab on it for you to tear off and fill in some information for us. You can leave it in the offering plate or at the welcome tent when you exit. So be sure to stop by there. Merry Christmas, everyone. So glad to see you. So I'm going to start us off with some scripture from Psalm 98. It says, "Sing a new song to the Lord, for he has performed wonders. His right hand and holy arm have won him victory. The Lord has made his victory known. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen our God's victory. Let the whole earth shout to the Lord. Be jubilant, shout for joy, and sing." And this is our Advent Sunday for joy. So I'm going to light our, traditionally it's pink. And I even practiced. And I knew that was going to happen. Yay! Right, church family, stand and sing with joy.
Let's sing Joy to the World together. Sing a song which is actually quite an old song. It was written about 400 years ago, and it's "God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen." But I wanted to just say a quick word about that beforehand. As Miss Nancy had mentioned earlier, it is the Sunday for joy as part of the Advent celebration. And when I was growing up, I always heard "God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen," and I thought that Mary was an adjective describing the gentleman. And I pictured these, you know, jovial guys with red faces, and that was just kind of my picture there. But as I actually looked into this song, there's actually a comma that comes after Mary before gentleman. And what it's actually saying is, may God make or keep you joyful or merry. And so as we sing it, it's basically a reminder to us as we reflect on our Savior's birth and his death and his resurrection, that how can we not be full of joy as the song says. And so we're going to sing it. It has a little additional part to it. I'm sure you'll pick that up real quickly here. But let's be reminded of the fact that God has filled us with joy through what he's done at Christmas. Turn your attention to the screens for this video on the Lottie Moon offering.
Виїжджали на 10-й день війни, і це був самий початок. Рішення прийняв чоловік відправити нас. Я їхала сама, вся родина залишилася вдома. Ми в безпеці, так. І, звичайно, перші слова чоловіку, що ми в безпеці вже. Все, ми на місці, ми у Польщі, нас добре прийняли.
Poland brought in the most refugees out of any country. And through that, the Lord opened the door for us to open a refugee center.
People stay in the house anywhere from 2 days to long term. We have one lady that's been there almost since it opened and is there currently.
Так, цей дім взагалі для мене став як другий дім, тому що ми майже рік тут. Холі, Крістін нас зустріла. Ну, тобто, реально так, я знову відчула, що я в безпеці. І мені необхідно було бути і серед людей, тому що, ну, також важкі часи, якось, ну, переживати це все разом було мені легше.
Like to hear what you think about having someone like Holly in the house.
Це наша друга мама, можна сказати.
We started a Bible study at the center, and one of the ladies one night was sharing with me that her family was against her studying religion or knowing anything about it, and she didn't know which one was true. And she said, so I just prayed and asked God if he would show me which one is true, which one should I believe, what can I believe? But then the war happened and I came here, and she's like, and then I realized that God led me here and he led me to you. And so she's like, and now I get to study the Bible and now I can learn. Those are the days that you leave super encouraged about what the Lord is doing. So those are good things.
Well, church family, it is, I don't know about you, but it's very encouraging to me to be reminded that we are part of something that is a lot bigger than just the body of Christ that is gathered here at 735 Park Street in Charlottesville. But that what we're a part of is impacting lives all around the world. We share these videos, especially during the Lottie Moon Christmas offering season, because 100% of the gifts from the Lottie Moon Christmas offering go to missionaries, just like Holly that you saw, that are serving in far-flung places like Poland, where they're helping Ukrainian refugees. And it's our honor and our privilege to be connected to over 3,500 international missionaries through the International Mission Board and to support their work. This year, we set a goal of $140,000 for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Through the 10th, which was last Sunday, our gifts totaled $175,516. Praise the Lord. And because many of you will send in gifts through the mail, I happen to know that that number is even higher yet now. It's well over 177. And so we're thankful for that. And that's before I put my check in, which means it's going to, like, go up more. I don't want to predict any thresholds it'll cross. But we're delighted to be a part of such a global ministry through the International Mission Board. But you should also know that we have missionaries that are members in this body that went out from here and went to the international mission field in a variety of different ways, who are serving in lots of different capacities. I see my friend Ann Hendricks sitting right over here, who's based out of Orlando, which is in itself a foreign mission field. But she works with Unto for Campus Crusade. And then Tim and Kathleen Pfeiffer, who packed up and moved out of here a number of years ago to go to Guatemala. And so, Tim, why don't you come up here just a minute? They're here. And I want to ask Tim to share with you a little bit about their ministry and just pray over him. And for some of you, if you're brand new to the life of the church, you may not have any idea who these folks are and you keep hearing about them. But so, Tim, remind me how long you've been in Guatemala.
So we have been there just over 5.5 years.
5.5 years. You went from Trader Joe's to Guatemala.
Yes.
Remember that when you're out shopping, that the Lord may take you from one place to another.
Exactly.
You were, the Lord gripped your heart about Guatemala on a mission trip. Is that right?
It is. So we have been going to Guatemala, I think,
eight
just
years?
Before you
yeah,
started.
Yeah, 8 or 9 years. Yeah.
Yeah, serving. And so it was on that first trip that God used me in a way that I didn't think could be possible.
Yeah.
And I learned from that no matter what we do, we need to get out of God's way and let God be God.
Yeah. Amen. And so tell us some of the stuff that you all do down there.
So we do a lot of different things. We're involved in English classes, music classes, open air evangelism, where our youth men are out sharing and praying with people on their own, like they've been discipled and to the point where they feel comfortable to go and share. We have a great prison ministry. I'm involved where I get to teach and preach on services Saturdays and Sundays. The girls are involved in music lessons and go weekly for training by someone who is well known in Guatemala and takes the time to train them. But we just continue to say yes to whatever God puts in on our plate.
And most recently, he put a bakery on your plate.
Yes.
You may remember a number of months ago, we were doing a fundraiser to help with providing several months worth of gifts for that. And I think we did, like 3 months or 4 months.
We had planned on 3 months, and I think the final number was almost 4.5. And
wow.
So we just thank you for that support and being able to not only pray for us, but just to encourage us in other ways as well, and whether it's messages or a little fundraiser project here and there. But it allows us to be involved in the community with our youth and employ them to the point where if they didn't have that opportunity, we don't know the choices they would be making.
Sure. Okay. And I saw when I walked in today, and maybe some of you saw, that there's all kinds of stuff out there. It seems to me that this is a week before Christmas. And so for some of the
men,
I will say men. I'll quote you. I didn't want to impugn all the men, but I will. So for some of you men who are like, oh yeah, I've got 7 shopping days left, this might be an opportunity for you to take care of that and set a record and have your Christmas gifts in hand a week ahead of time.
You don't need to go through Amazon. There's no shipping charges.
You brought it to us. I mean, that's, it's better than Amazon.
It is.
Yeah,
it
is. You're north of the Amazon anyway, so where you're at in Guatemala.
It's all things that are made by individuals in Guatemala.
Yeah.
I would say the majority of them are all Christian. A lot of them are single moms who are trying to support their families.
Right.
And so we support them and bring it back as an opportunity for here.
So feel free to stop by there. And I think you and Kathleen, y'all are going to be out there after the service as well.
Yes.
So if you have not got a chance to meet them in person, be sure to do that when the service is concluded. I want to pray for you. Over you and ask God's blessing upon you as we pray together as a church. Father, thank you for Tim, for Kathleen, for their family, for the sacrifice they made of packing up and leaving the comforts of life in the United States for the unknown. Thank you for your Holy Spirit going before them and guiding them in that decision. And as you have used these 5.5 years to mold and to shape them, we pray you would continue to mold and shape them into the image of Christ as they serve you there in Guatemala. We pray that they would have open doors for the gospel, that they would have favor with those that they share the gospel with and that they disciple. And we pray that even as they disciple others, they too would continue to be growing in their relationship with you as all of us are. Lord, we're thankful to be able to partner with them. We pray your richest blessing upon them. We pray for our time of offering as we give, knowing that a portion of that goes not only to international missionaries like Holly in Poland, but a portion of that also goes to support families like Tim and Kathleen and Anne and others that we support as missionaries and ministry partners. Thank you for a church that is passionate about giving away a part of what you bring to us for the sake of the kingdom. And may we, as individual believers, choose to live on less to do more through your kingdom. So we pray your richest blessing upon the offering, the gifts that are given, and those that give them today. In Jesus' name, amen. And thank you, brother. Thank you so much. So we are going to receive our offering today. If you're a guest this morning, we don't ask you to give anything. We're just glad you're here. We hope you stop by the guest tent. We do have a gift we'd like to put in your hands, and certainly we'd love to meet you. But if you consider First Baptist your church home, then during this time is your opportunity to give and support what the Lord is doing in this place and around the world.
We worship the God who was.
going to do a new song. This is one that the students do downstairs. We learned it at summer camp last year, and it's called Abide. And I just wanted to share a quick word about it, because as we're talking about joy this morning and singing about joy this morning, joy comes from being connected to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the source of all joy. And in John 15, verse 5, Jesus says to us, "I am the vine and you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit. And apart from me, you can do nothing." And so joy is not something that we just have to manufacture or work up, but it's something that comes from the vine as we stay connected to him. And so this song is a good reminder for us of who Jesus is and of our total dependence on him. And so we're going to sing it for you. As you learn the melody, we invite you to jump in and sing it aloud along with us.
may be seated. I invite you to open your Bibles to Luke chapter 2. And certainly thank you to our student ministry for leading us in worship this morning. They do a wonderful job. Doug, you must be the senior in the student ministry. Appreciate you sitting in with them today. Luke chapter 2, we're going to continue our series called Old-Fashioned Christmas. And as I mentioned to you, I tried to think through some of the things that are in the Christmas story and how they relate to what we think of as an old-fashioned Christmas. And so some of those things are having family gathered around and singing. And one of them is getting outside, doing outside sorts of activities. In fact, I have it on good authority that if you want to have a meaningful, Hallmark-worthy Christmas, you have to do some stuff that's outside. And so that can be all kinds of things. We do it here at the church. We do the caroling on our lawn. We do that the first weekend of December, the first Saturday there in December. And so we did that. We gathered together and we sang songs together and ate donuts and fellowshipped and ate donuts and fellowshipped and ate donuts and had hot shots. So some of us probably got more of that than we should have. But there's all kinds of things like that. I mean, you can go to the Winter Wander deal that's over at Boar's Head and that outdoor experience, or the Lewis Ginter Botanical Garden in Richmond has a big light display there. You can do that. It's all outside. And there are benefits to getting outside. WebMD, the source for all things medical, lists a number of benefits for getting outside. I looked them up. It says it helps you get exercise. And the way we eat during the holidays, that's probably a good thing. It helps you get vitamin D. It lessens anxiety. It's social. It improves your sleep. It helps you feel better about yourself. It improves your focus. It gives you better immunity. It boosts your creativity. It helps you keep a healthy weight. And I read that list. I thought, I got to get outside right now. I mean, I got to go. And then just below that was another paragraph. And that paragraph was entitled, What to Watch Out For. And I thought, okay, well, you've motivated me to get outside. What do I need to watch out for? And it read this way, Protect yourself from the sun with long sleeves, sunglasses, and a hat. Use broad spectrum sunscreen, SPF 15 or higher, even when it's cloudy. Try to let people know where you go, especially if you're going alone into a wilderness area. Grab a jacket if the weather looks iffy, and charge your phone in case you need a map or to call someone. And remember, your phone may not work in some areas, especially in a remote wilderness area. And all of a sudden, getting outside didn't seem like it was lessening my anxiety. In fact, it seemed like everything from the sun to the wilderness was going to try to kill me if I got outside. And suddenly I felt like being on my couch was probably the exact right place for me to be. But that's just the day and age we live in, right? Even WebMD has to put on a paragraph to say, you should get outside. But hey, in case you tend to sue us, we need to give you all these warnings. Well, there were a lot of people in that early Christmas story, that very first Christmas, there were a lot of people who were outside. And I want us to look at a very familiar passage of Scripture and think about it a little differently. So Luke chapter 2, we're going to read verses 8 through 20 as we read the Christmas story about some of those folks who were outside that very first Christmas. So if you would stand, please, as we read God's Word, and we honor the God of the Word by standing. Luke chapter 2, starting with verse 8, I'm reading to you from the CSB. It says this, In the same region, shepherds were staying out in the fields and keeping watch at night over their flock. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, Don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today, in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be the sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped tightly in cloth and lying in a manger. Suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly host with the angel praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors. When the angels had left them and returned to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go straight to Bethlehem and see what has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." They hurried off, and they found both Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And after seeing them, they reported the message they were told about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary was treasuring up all these things in her heart and meditating on them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard, which were just as they had been told. Would you join me in a word of prayer, please? Father, we are indeed thankful for your word and for how it speaks to us. And this Christmas season, particularly as we are reflecting on the birth of Jesus and we're anticipating that, even as we are making plans with family and family coming in and us going to visit them and all of the different activities that are going to be swirling around us in the next week to 10 days, Lord, help us to pause for just a minute and remember the Christ who is at the center of Christmas. Father, I pray this morning that as we look at this passage of Scripture, that you would guard the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart on this text. May they be pleasing in your sight, for you are my rock and my redeemer. And indeed, you are our rock and our redeemer. May you be praised today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. You know, the beautiful thing about Scripture is that you can never fully empty the well that is God's Word. There's always something in it that the Holy Spirit uses to speak to us. And a passage like this we have looked at, and you've looked at it before. You've learned it in Sunday school. You have heard it countless messages during Christmas time from this particular text of Scripture. And what I want to do today is I want to sort of turn this text a little bit, much like turning a diamond, to see it from a different angle, to think about it from a different perspective. And the perspective I want us to think about it from is being outside. And so I want to do that by asking a few questions. The first one is this: why are the shepherds outside? Why are the shepherds outside? We know in verse 8 that these shepherds are out in their fields, they're keeping watch over their flocks at night. But why are they there? Well, there's a number of reasons why they're there. An open range is a very dangerous place for sheep. Sheep are a prey animal. You know, most animals are divided into predator and prey. And sheep are a prey animal. When they're faced with danger, their natural instinct is to flee, not fight. Their strategy is to use avoidance and rapid flight to avoid being eaten. Left to themselves, out in that open range, they are very susceptible to wolves. They're susceptible to being killed. So the shepherds are there to protect the sheep. And the only way for a shepherd to protect the sheep is for the shepherd to be with the sheep. He has to be there with them. In fact, he's with them so much that the sheep recognize the voice of the shepherd. People who raise sheep and study such things tell us that sheep can immediately recognize the voice of someone who is a familiar, trusted person. So this individual who has been with them and has been spending time with them and has been speaking to them, speaking into their life, so to speak. The sheep recognize that voice. They remember that person who handles them. They remember that person who cares for them. They remember that person who provides for them. And they remember those who inflict abuse upon them as well. So the shepherds are out there, at least in part, to protect the sheep. But that's not the only reason they're out there. We're told in the text a very specific reason why they are out there. The most likely reason that they're out there is because it was the birthing season for lambs. This was the time when the shepherds had to be there. Now, some people try to figure out the date, the actual precise date of the birth of Jesus by trying to figure out the birthing season for lambs and all that kind of good stuff. Well, if you want to try to do that, you knock yourself out. But I'm going to tell you, good luck. Good luck. The Awassi sheep, which are native or indigenous to Israel, they give birth generally December to January, but there are other sheep that have been imported as well, and they give birth anytime between December and June. So pinpointing a date so that you can figure out exactly when the birth of Jesus was or exactly when the shepherds were in that field, that's a pretty tough task. We don't know the exact day and time, but we do know that the shepherds were spending the night in the fields with their flocks, and in all likelihood, it's because it was during the birthing season of lambs, the time when the sheep were the most vulnerable and when they needed their shepherd the very most. And if you think about it, it makes really good sense in the way God does things, because there those shepherds are all around them hearing the sounds of lambs being born when the angels appear and tell them about another lamb that's been born, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So the shepherds are outside for good reason. In fact, it's remarkable that they leave their flock, that the call of God on their life, the announcement is so dramatic that they leave their flock to go see about this child who's been born. But understand, the shepherds are not just outside physically. They're also outside socially. Shepherds were the lowest strata of society. They were among the poorest and the humblest of all those occupations in first century Israel. They were poor, hardworking people. They did not have positions of power. They did not have positions of authority. In fact, they were considered unreliable. That's why their testimony was not accepted in courts of law. They were not able to observe Israel's ceremonial laws due to the nature of their work, and that caused people to view them with suspicion and question. Being a shepherd was a dirty job. Mike Rowe would have covered shepherds on his old TV show, Dirty Jobs. It was a dirty, smelly job. But the truth of the matter is, caring shepherds smell like sheep. If you're going to be a shepherd who cares for the flock, you're going to smell like the sheep. So these were common people. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that God loves common people. They're not the kind of people who the greatest news in the universe is typically delivered. But that's exactly what God does. God sends the news of the gospel, the good news of the birth of Jesus, not to kings and not to emperors, not to palaces, not to the news media, not to religious leaders, but to the outcast, the overlooked, the despised, the rejected. It's to them that the message goes first. And they're told about a baby who's been born, not in a home, not in a palace. That's not where they would find him. They would find him lying in a manger, a feeding trough for the animals. So that makes me ask the question, why was Jesus outside? I mean, the shepherds were outside. We talked about that. Why was Jesus outside? If we were to have read the first seven verses, we would have found, of chapter 2, we'd have found out that Mary and Joseph arrive in Bethlehem at about the time that she is due to give birth. Joseph is, of course, headed back to the city of his family. This is where his family origins were at, and with the census that had been decreed, he had to go back to that city at the time of the census. And folks sometimes wonder, well, why in the world would you drag along this betrothed wife who is very much with child and ready to be giving birth at any particular moment? Well, that's probably exactly why he took her along. Joseph, in all likelihood, had plenty of extended family in Bethlehem, and he was likely planning to stay with them. This is not a situation where Mary and Joseph show up in Bethlehem and they're going from the Hampton Inn to the Holiday Inn, to the Motel 6, even to the Red Roof Inn, the La Quinta, the Super 8. They're not going from hotel to hotel trying to find a place because they don't know anybody in this town and they don't know where to stay. No, that's not the case at all. They're going to that city not only because it was a city of his origin and so forth, but because they have extended family there. That's why he takes along this wife who is ready to have a baby, ready to give birth. He takes her along because he knows that there in Bethlehem, he has plenty of extended family to help. The extended family was the birthing team. Grandmas, aunts, nieces, they all pitched in. And so Joseph is taking Mary to Bethlehem where he knows he will have a team of people that will be able to help at that point. But it's true there were also a whole lot of other people traveling to Bethlehem too. Bethlehem's not all that large. It's a sleepy little bedroom community just outside of Jerusalem. So those places where people did take in travelers for money, those inns, they were full. But the reality is, so were most of the homes of the extended family. Because everybody's coming to town. And if you've ever been, if you've ever had the experience of having a big Christmas gathering or Thanksgiving gathering or any other such holiday gathering where all of the family descends upon one house. Any of y'all ever had that experience? Some of you have. I know by the look in your eye that some of you are anticipating it. And some of you are trying to figure out how you can get down to the garage to tinker. I said, honey, are you coming up? Oh, just a minute. Just a minute. I got to figure out how to rewire this thingamajig. You have to do it now? Yes. Yes. When there's 17 children in my house, I have to find out right now how to rewire this thing. Now, I heard those amens. Some of you men are like, that's a good idea. I'm going to put off those to-do list until that day. The houses were full. The houses were full. Now, that does not mean that there was no place for them to stay. It means there was not a very private place to have a baby. And so when they get, in fact, when you look at the text, if you were to look back at verse 7 in the CSB, it says, she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him tightly in cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. The King James has done us a little bit of a disservice by saying there was no room for them in the inn that made us think that they were trying to get into a Super 8. And that's not the case. There was simply no guest room. There was no space available with privacy sufficient for her to have a child. And so the homeowner, whether they were an innkeeper or not, it's irrelevant. The homeowner, the family member said, we got to find a private place. And the most private place we can figure out is this place where the animals are kept. That's away from all the family. That's the equivalent of dad going to the garage during the family gathering. And so there she gives birth to her son. And she puts him in a cattle trough, a manger. Place where the animals ate their food, but because of its shape and its size and its design, it was perfect for the manger of a baby. And so there Jesus is born, surrounded by Mary and Joseph and extended family members and a few animals. The King of Kings is born. And in that bustling house that day, that bustling house that night, as people knew she was about to give birth and they knew she was off in this little private area, they hear the cry of the baby Jesus. He's born not in a palace. He's not born in a place of power or prestige. Just over the rise in Jerusalem, that's where the power brokers lived. No, he was born in a nondescript animal pen. That's where the God of the universe took on human flesh. Now, the physical location, the actual location is not known, but it most assuredly was outside. We know for sure it was not in the living quarters of the house. The God of nature is born in the very nature that he created. The one who called himself the Good Shepherd was born outside, just like those other shepherds were tending their flocks at night. But he's not just born outside for a practical reason, but he's also born outside socially. Mary and Joseph are not married. They're betrothed. And we knew the reason that she was pregnant. We've read it in the scripture. Joseph knew the reason she was pregnant. An angel told him. Mary knew the reason she was pregnant. An angel had told her. But nobody else in the rest of the world would have believed them. Outside of maybe a few family members. No. They would have been traveling, getting all kinds of looks, carrying with it all kinds of cultural shame. She was on the outside, socially as well. Now, her family would have stood by her. They would have borne that shame as well. But understand, Jesus was outside socially. In fact, in Jesus' life and ministry, that social stigma, the social stigma from his birth, stayed with him. In John chapter 8, he's in a heated debate with the Pharisees. You can look this up later. And they say to Jesus, "We were not the ones born of sexual immorality." Don't you just hate it when somebody brings up something from your past and throws it in your face? You hate that? I don't know about you. Maybe you've never made a mistake. But I've made some mistakes in my time. I've made some whoppers in my time. And the thing that cuts the deepest is when somebody years later brings it back up. Right? And that's what happens here. 30 years after Jesus is born, if not more than that, these Pharisees, these religious leaders are insinuating back to his birth that he is born of sexual immorality, of infidelity, that he's a social outcast, that he has no business speaking to those religious leaders given his background, given what his parents did. He's born outside socially, a social outcast, a son of infidelity. That's what he was called. But he wasn't outside socially because he actually was a son of infidelity. He was outside socially because that's where the people he came to save are. He's accused of being a son of a sinful woman, not because she actually was a sinful woman in the sense of his birth. But he's accused of that because he came to save sinful men and women. Which leads me to wonder this question. Are you outside? Are you outside? You say, well, no, I'm sitting in this nice, comfortable church, actually, today. Well, maybe you're inside physically, but are you outside? You see, when the angels appeared to the shepherds to inform them of the birth of Jesus, they do so in two parts, an announcement and a song. Their announcement contains more than the directions of how to get to Bethlehem and to where Jesus is, but it includes an announcement as to why Jesus has been born. Look at verse 11. "Today, in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah, the Lord." In that verse are three significant titles that Jesus has. He's the Savior. In fact, G. Campbell Morgan, the great commentator, the great preacher who wrote a commentary on this book, says he is called Savior because he confronts the sins of the world. He is the Messiah because he confronts the chaos of the world. And he is Lord because he confronts eternity and the age to come. He is Savior, Messiah, Lord. The angels say that this is good news, and they're right, because without a Savior, we have no hope. The Bible teaches our sins have separated us from God. And without a Savior, we have no hope of ever bridging that gap. I've often described it like this. If you've ever been to the Grand Canyon, it's fairly wide. It's fairly wide. And every once in a while, you find some folks that go out on the edge. They go out to the rocks. They get over the fence, and they try to get their picture where it looks like they're right on the edge, because they are right on the edge. And I've always used this example that if we were standing at the edge of the Grand Canyon and a few of us gathered up there, especially some men types, you know, who are known for saying, "Watch this," right? And I said, "Well, you know, Bill, I don't know. I bet you I could jump farther out there than you could." And Bill says, "Oh, you ain't gonna jump farther than me." And then, of course, I'm just pulling these names out of the air. Dale says, "I can jump farther than either one of you two guys." And then the young, strapping student pastors, I mean, Benji says, "You guys are a lot older than me. I could get farther than you." And so we decide to have a little contest, and we go out there, and I jump out there, and I get about 8 feet. And then Bill jumps out there and he gets about 8.5 feet. And Dale jumps out there and he gets 7 feet because he overestimated his abilities. He gets 7 feet. And then Benji gets out there and he gets out there 12 feet. And on his way down, he says, "Told you." Where do all of us end up? In a lot of trouble. That's where we end up. We end up at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. There's a gap between us and God that's wider than any Grand Canyon. And it doesn't matter how good of a person you think you are, and it doesn't matter how much you compare yourself with others. I will guarantee you there are people in this room who are better people than I am. And I can guarantee you that there's a few people in this room that I'm a better person than you are. And here's the truth of the matter. All of our goodness ends us at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. Dead. Separated from God. But Jesus comes. And he bridges that gap with the cross. And if we'll go through that cross, we can walk over to the other side. Not with our abilities of how far we can jump, but because of his provision, we can get to the other side. All of us have been born spiritually outside. We've rebelled against God. We've gone our own way. We've done things our own way. And the result is absolutely devastating. And the Bible says that without Christ, we are alone and without hope in the world. We are outside and we are destined to stay outside. But that's why Jesus came. He came outside to meet us who are outside. Notice the angel's announcements followed by a heavenly chorus bursting forth in the song saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors." If God's peace is to people he favors, we have to ask, who is that? Who does God favor? And Luke does not leave us without a clue. Just one chapter later, he identifies the one with whom God is pleased. If you have your Bible still open, I hope you do. If you'll turn them to Luke chapter 3. Verse 22, at the baptism of Jesus, we read that the Holy Spirit descended on him in a physical appearance like a dove, and a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." The word used in Luke 3:22 that's translated "well pleased" is eudokios. It's the same root word that's translated "favor." Dakasa, which is found in Luke 2:14. They come from the same root word. The point is, God says, the angels say here that peace to those on whom he favors. And just one chapter later in Jesus' baptism, 30 years later in terms of time, God says, "You are the one in whom I find favor." That God is pleased with Jesus. And any of us, when we think about our mortality and we think about the day we're going to stand before God, if you say, "Well, I hope God is pleased with me," let me tell you right now, I'm going to burst your bubble a week before Christmas. He's not. And he never will be. Apart from Christ. But if you are in Christ, then God is well pleased with you in Christ. But apart from Christ, you can be the best person that the world thinks has ever lived, the most moral person, the most decent person, the kindest person. You can be all those things you want to be. But in the history of all humanity, God has only been pleased with one. And that's his Son, the Lord Jesus. That's why when we preach and teach in this church, we emphasize so much you need to be in a personal relationship with Christ, because apart from him, there's no way to be right with God. There's no way to experience forgiveness of your sins and eternal life. The only way for God to be pleased with you is for you to be found in a relationship with Jesus. And you find that relationship by repenting of your sins and by believing in what Jesus did for you on the cross. And when you do that, whether you're a social outcast like a bunch of shepherds out in the fields, or whether you're lost in a bustling city like Mary and Joseph, you are welcomed inside of God's family. While WebMD may say getting outside is good for your health, getting inside to God's family is good for your soul. And it's the only way to have eternal life. And so I wonder, are you outside? Or have you turned to Christ and are trusting in Him today? And if you haven't trusted Him yet, I pray that you would this day. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Father, we are thankful for your word, and we're thankful for the reminder that we must find ourselves in Christ. And I pray this morning that if there's anybody in this room or watching by live stream that's not sure that they're in a relationship with you, Lord, I pray that they would repent of their sins, that they would ask your forgiveness for their sins right now, and ask you to come into their life to be their Lord and their Savior. And Lord, your word tells us that if we'll repent of our sins, if we'll trust in you, if we will declare you are the Lord of our lives, and we'll believe in our heart that you have been raised from the dead, Father, we know, your word tells us, that we'll be saved. And so, Lord, I pray that there wouldn't be a single person leave here today without knowing for sure that they have gone from being outside to inside your family. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to invite you to stand, please, as we sing a song of response. As we do, I'll be right down here at the front and be happy to pray with you about anything you're wrestling with today. Amen. Y'all may be seated. It's been good to be in the Lord's house today. Amen, church? Amen. So just a couple of quick things by way of announcement. On the back of your bulletin, we've got several of them mentioned. Our spring semester for Life University is going to kick off on January the 10th. And we have an opportunity for you to sign up for classes. There have been two classes added to the list that's on your bulletin. They are reflected on the screen. Sam Raju is going to lead a class on the atonement, and Larry Sides is going to lead a Bible book study of the book of Philemon. So that's in addition to the other classes that are on the back of the bulletin. And so we invite you to sign up for those. Don't forget our Christmas Eve activities next week. No Sunday school next week on Christmas Eve. No Sunday school on New Year's Eve. But we do have worship at 10:45, and then, of course, our candlelighting service at 5:30. And then one other opportunity for you to be a part of some things this Christmas season, we are partnering with the Church of the Good Shepherd. They are working with Pachem to help house 35 homeless guys over the holiday season. I think we've got a slide up for that. And so they have several opportunities for you to partner with them. You can volunteer to help in some way. You can help make a meal. You can donate snacks and supplies. You can find all that at fbcps.com/Pachem. So we're partnering with Church of the Good Shepherd for that. In fact, next week at our Christmas Eve candlelighting service, when we collect an offering, I've already talked to Pastor Cunningham over at Church of the Good Shepherd, and we'll be donating that offering to them for their efforts as they seek to meet that really significant need within the community. And so some opportunities for you to get involved in what is going on as well. So again, fbcps.com/Pachem, and you can find out more. We always do a time of recognition for employees who reach anniversary milestones. And so this morning, Mr. Wanamaker, why don't you make your way down here for just a minute. Doug, this month, October or December, what month is this? December? Yeah, I get lost in the shuffle. You have reached a milestone of 10 years at First Baptist Church. So now, for most of that, you have been working with Pastor Dale, who regrettably is not able to be here today, but he has left you a message. So turn your attention to the screens there and see what we got.
Good morning, church family. I wanted to take just a moment to recognize my friend, our brother, Doug Wanamaker, for 10 years of faithful service here at First Baptist Church. You know, one of the great joys I have in serving on staff at First Baptist is serving with what our music folks call the D team, Don, Doug, and Dale. Doug, I just want to say a personal word of thanks to you for all you do in our worship ministry. Thank you for the incredible artistry and creativity you bring to our team. Thank you for the encouragement and the help that you provide to our instrumentalists week in and week out. And brother, thank you for your friendship to me and to many others on our team and your continued partnership in gospel ministry. And specifically, brother, I also want to thank you for your faithfulness. Doug, you've continued to show me and our church an example of what faithful service to Christ looks like. So church family, would you join me this morning in honoring Doug Wanamaker on 10 years of faithful service at FBC?
Doug, we love you. We have a formal letter of appreciation here as well as a financial gift in keeping with our personnel manual, in which we're delighted to provide to you. And again, thank you so much for all that you do.
Thank you, Darrell, and thank you, everybody.
Appreciate it.
It's a blessing to be part of this
family. Amen. Thank you, brother. All right. Where's my deacon of the day? There he is. My C2 deacon of the day. We have that running joke around here about our deacons. It's on. Should be ready to go. All right, brother. Set us out the right way.
All right. C4 refers to an explosive in the military. Let's not go there. So we only have C3. The flowers are in loving memory of Aunt Beulah Carter, those of you who remember her, she was an embodiment of Lottie Moon and would do skits. We didn't get a chance to do that, but we knew her as Boots. Good friend of Louise, June Seal, has donated these flowers. And those of you that remember Boots, just a wonderful woman, and the flowers are in memory of her. And I'll be here if you have any questions or want to have a prayer afterwards. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, God Emmanuel, with us, and Jesus means Savior. Lord, we just thank you so much for this season that you give us joy. Help us remember that through the week to go in peace and serve you. In Jesus' name, amen.